So, actually, it is true. It is almost 30 years now that I am putting needles around the body, producing ice creams. And it is a great pleasure and honor to be here to share a little bit of my, not of my experience, but more than my experience, my point of view. And as I always say, it is more important to know the friends that you have than to describe who you are. And I have some very good friends. These people and the friends of my friends are my friends, of course. So, speaking a moment about the International Society of Cardiosurgery that was founded in 1974, many, many years ago, with the help of Professor Seja, Haske, and Dr. Ablin, most of them, unfortunately, are late. Ablin is still with us. And we had a lot of meetings during the time around the world. And the last two have been in Guangzhou, China, while we had in 2009 a great, fantastic, beautiful, unique meeting in St. Petersburg. And this will remain in my heart forever. So, one of the founders, just a few weeks or months trespassing from this life, Professor Giovanni Seja was so kind to mention the importance of cryosurgery and to the cryosurgeons around the world at the meeting in Trieste. And we had this meeting, and the society wanted to promote the medical education. And what Professor Belyayev has just finished to say, and in his wonderful presentation, he really catch all the points that are needed to be caught in this situation. We need people who teach and who explain, who win the heart of the people. But to get to the heart, you need to go through the brain. So you need to give some real stuff to be not believed, but to be proven. So the last meeting has been in Tianjin, always an internet meeting because of the COVID restriction that confirmed Professor Qi Guo of Tianjin, again president of the society. We all know this, but it is nice to go back for a few seconds. We started 30 years ago with liquid nitrogen that were bulky, super powerful, very difficult to use, big probes. Then we went to T. Zhao Thomson devices with argon gas, much more precise, maybe with the help of computer to drive our needles inside the prostate. And that was good, it was fun. And then we got even the variable probes that allowed us to size the ball exactly how big we wanted it. And this is certainly that something that is helping a lot to perform well a cryosurgery. That is always a teamwork, and here we have a prostate cryosurgery and the ultrasound, of course. So slowly we got to the last years, and here we are today. The advantages of cryo is the possibility to monitor in real time the freezing that you are doing. It can be CT, can be ultrasound, can be MRI, but this is a very unique fashion that cryo has. But unfortunately, at the rim of the freeze, cells can survive, and it is difficult to know if what we are ablating that we see as an ice ball is really ablating all it is included inside this ice ball. For this reason, as you know, we need to freeze two times and certain times three times to achieve a better margin. But this, of course, causes some more lengthy procedure. And of course, when you got to very low temperatures inside the tumor, you need, of course, to extend the ice outside. And this makes things a little bit problematic for the surrounding and sensitive tissues and organs that can cause the so-called collateral damage. I just pick up from the literature something that show us in some fields what we are, where we are up to at this moment. This is emotion. Motion, it was a nine center, different center study for pain, bone pain palliation. And it proved that cryo works. We all know who does these things knows that it works very nicely. It is interesting to say, to see what they say, that it has been able, they've been able to reduce the opioid absorption by a lot of them while we were, they were doing cryo and after cryo. But this is, I would say, good, but we can achieve better, because when you have nine sites, you can assume that some of them are not very expert, or they could be at the starting of the learning curve. So probably when you have these not verified quality systems in not all verified centers, the results are good, but could be better. And in my opinion, they can be better in very well-trained centers. Interesting, the breast. The breast is something that is very controversial. It is obvious that everybody is afraid of touching breast with cryo because of the so well consolidated technique as a lumpectomy or mastectomy, but there are a lot of people who have done cases for some unresectable or for other reasons, people who didn't want to receive a lumpectomy using cryo. And look at here, please. I think this is very interesting. The reported variable, local tumor control, ranging from 19 to 95%. Do you see? What does this mean? This means that people who have 19% of local control, they don't know how to do cryo. It is obvious, because it is impossible to have such bad results if you know what you are doing. If you know what we are doing, a much higher good result are certainly possible, as everybody who has some years of experience know in the treatment also, and not only of breast. But in this work, it was very interesting what was outlined. The possibility to use, together with cryo, also some immunotherapy. And we know how well checkpoint inhibitors can do, the CTLA-4, PD-L1 inhibitors can help in some everyday widening picture to achieve good control and good results after the cryo and together with the cryo. And this is certainly the present that is already here. A lot of people have experience in this. I've started 7 years ago, 100 of patients, and sometime we can discuss this, but it is not today the day for it. Interesting, this work that compares in lung, the comparison in between microwave and cryoablation. And the overall study demonstrate that they are both very effective, especially for small lesions. For larger lesions, microwave is more effective, it seems in this work at least, of course, with some more complication and more problematic application of it. And let's go to kidney. Everybody experiments cryo in the kidney from the beginning. It's one of the preferable therapies that we can use. And we have seen that when we compare a partial nephrectomy, which is extirpative surgery, a laparoscopic, robotic, open, whatever it is, to cryo alone, of course, the results of cryo are a little bit worse in overall cause of mortality or specific cause of mortality. But side effects are minimal, affecting the extraction of creatinine is very less damaging the kidney. And again, there is a bias in this study, because generally you give minimally invasive cryo to those patients that are weak with comorbidities, age, and problems. So it turns out that even the overall mortality has no sense, because we are comparing apples with peaches. We are not comparing in between apples and apples. So when you read an article like this, you have to be very smart. Look and check what they are saying in deep. So here we are again. I have to put myself here because with Boris, we started to study some time ago, and I presented some slides last time in for St. Petersburg meeting in 2020, and we have started to try to add to cryo something more to see what happens. This something more is electricity. So doing cryo plus electricity, cryo plus electrolysis. And these two techniques are in reality the eldest technique, because ice has been applied since 18th century, and the electrolysis is the same. They are very old technique, and were proven to be working from the very beginning. But nobody had the idea, as Boris did, to try to put them together and see what happens. So we did it. We did a lot of studies in animal, in laboratory, et cetera, and we proved that it is really working and doing fine. In the laboratory, we saw that it is possible to drive the electrolysis force through the ice to the edge of the ice. And this makes a huge difference, because this means that that layer of 1 centimeter is surrounding the ice ball, where you can have some vital cells can be overcome by applying over the cryo electrolysis. And this means that we can achieve the cellular destruction to the edge of the ice ball. The consequences of this are very strong. First of all, this means that you don't need 3 or 2 cycles of freeze. One is enough. Where is ice, you can apply the electrolysis. And once you have done this, and after electrolysis, you don't need to heat, because electrolysis has already detached the probe. You can move it away. So at the end of the story, a procedure that generally would last 40 minutes will last around 20, with much cheaper use of gas or liquid nitrogen or whatever it is. So my conclusions are this. In the past, we had liquid nitrogen. In the present, we have argon helium, or the super good technology with liquid nitrogen produced by the Russian team led by George Prokhorov, with fantastic probes, very effective, very good, reusable, cheap, and super powerful. But the future is here, where we can add to cryo something more, having a device that will combine freezing and electricity. Having a complete ablation to the edge of the ice ball, you will visualize what you see, and what you see is what you get. It is not a guess, as now with cryo alone. And we can ablate near the blood vessels without any risk of damaging them too much. And these are my last slides. What does this mean? That with one probe of 1.2 millimeters, we can get an ice ball of a diameter of 35 by 52, which is comparable to the 1.7 of Endocare, which are the most used probes. But this means that what is really ablated by the gas only is this. What you get with the gas plus electricity is this. So the real ablation zone is total. And if we compare a 3.8, which is one of the most powerful cryoprobe now in use, and we say that we get an ice ball of 45 by 64, but the real ablation is 24 by 44, and we compare to 35 to 52 of the 1.2, that means 25% of the diameter of the other probe, and we get a double volume. Because when you compare 35 by 52 as ablated volume, and you compare it with 24 and 44, this means, because it's a volume with a triple, with a square, the cubic diameter multiplication, that means that with 1.2 probe, you get twice the ablation area of a 3.8 ablation probe. This is not already commercial because, of course, you know how difficult it is to translate an idea to the clinical studies, but here we are. And it is a pleasure for me to anticipate this also because, you know, nobody works alone. You need team. You need teamwork to verify and to check what you are doing. And for this reason, I have a very strong feeling that we can work together to make this technology easily implemented inside the existing devices so that we can help in not always, because probably this technology may not be needed in all situations, but sometime it could be certainly interesting to have the possibility to add the two combination therapies. So this is my presentation, and I'm happy to receive your questions.